Hey everyone, Professor Dave here. I want to talk to you a little bit about resonance structures and how to assign formal charge.
He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
So a very important concept in organic chemistry is resonance. And in order to understand resonance, we're going to have to understand pi electrons, because pi electrons are the ones that participate in resonance. So a pi bond, basically, if we remember, a double or a triple carbon-carbon bond consists of one sigma bond and either one or two pi bonds. So here is a carbon-carbon double bond. One of those bonds is a sigma bond and the other is a pi bond. So let's take a look at some orbitals and see what's going on. So let's take this flat alkene, remembering that carbons that are participating in a double bond are sp2 hybridized, right? They have hybridized their atomic orbitals into sp2 molecular orbitals because they have three electron domains each, the other carbon and then whatever else they're bound to. So let's take this flat molecule and we're gonna flip it like this and view it edge on. Okay, so these hydrogens are away from us further past the board. These hydrogens are towards us precisely in a plane perpendicular to the board. And then what we're seeing is that the carbon is bound to these other three atoms, the carbon and the two hydrogen atoms, by its sp2 molecular orbitals, right? But that leaves an unhybridized p orbital extending in perpendicular fashion up and down in the opposite directions. And it is the overlap of these p orbitals that is generating the pi bond, right? This carbon-carbon bond is the sigma bond, and then this is the pi bond. Now, the reason this is important is because it is the electrons in pi bonds, as well as electrons that are present as lone pairs, that are the ones that are going to participate in resonance. So, most resonance structures are going to contain atoms that bear a formal charge. So before we investigate these structures, I wanted to review really quickly how we can tell whether an atom will bear a formal charge. So let's take a look at some of these polyatomic ions. So for example, in this structure, why is it that that oxygen atom has a formal negative charge localized on that oxygen atom? Well, in order to tell if an atom is going to have a formal charge, we can look in the periodic table to see how many valence electrons that atom ought to have. Now, oxygen, if we look in the table, is in the sixth column, so it should have six valence electrons. But here, if we were to go ahead and draw in all of the lone pairs, we could see that this oxygen atom is actually showing seven electrons in this structure, in this Lewis dot structure, because we have three lone pairs, so that's six electrons, and then one of the electrons in this covalent bond belongs to that oxygen. The other belongs to this carbon. So this oxygen is showing seven electrons in this Lewis dot structure. That's one more than its typical valence of six. One additional negatively charged particle means that this oxygen has a formal negative charge. Now, for example, let's look at the nitrogen atom in the nitrate ion. Now, nitrogen ought to have five valence electrons. But here, it is contributing only four to this Lewis dot structure because it is participating in four covalent bonds, one here, and then two, both a sigma and a pi bond in that double bond. So one per bond, four electrons that this nitrogen is contributing to this Lewis dot structure. Four is one less than five. One fewer negatively charged particles means that this nitrogen bears a formal positive charge. So that is the simplest way to tell if an atom has a formal charge. A lot of books or teachers will give you this very strange way of using arithmetic and adding and subtracting all these things, but in my opinion, this is the simplest way. Just compare the number of electrons that an atom is contributing to a Lewis dot structure to its typical valence. And if they are not the same, that atom must bear a formal charge. So now that we're able to understand that, let's take a look at some of these resonance structures. Now, it is the case that pi electrons are delocalizable within a structure. That means that if pi electrons can be rearranged to form some other stable resonance structure, they will do so. So Once again, sigma electrons cannot do this because they are electrons that are involved in direct orbital overlap. So those are not delocalizable. But the pi electrons, the ones that are the lateral overlap of p orbitals or lone pairs, those are free to move around. So, for example, we've got a negative charge here, which is essentially just a lone pair. So let's say a lone pair goes ahead and forms a double bond there. Now, the only way that this carbon can accept another electron from some other atom is if it then loses an electron. In other words, it must lose a bond. It can accept a bond from this electron, or sorry, from this oxygen, if it then loses a bond and those electrons go somewhere else. Well, this oxygen is just as capable of accommodating a negative charge as this one is. So that means that this is an equally valid resonance structure as this one is. Right, so we can have the negative charge on this oxygen or go ahead and form the carbonyl there and bring the negative charge up to that oxygen. So these are two equally valid resonance structures of the same molecule. Now, the convention is to list them in brackets with this double-headed arrow between them. That's just how we do it. And then also, with regards to these electron pushing arrows, those are something we're going to see a lot more later with some of the mechanism stuff. And these are very important to be drawn in a very particular way. This must go from electron rich to electron poor, in other words, from the lone pair to the bond itself. So we'll get much deeper into those arrows later. Now, the important thing that we want to understand about resonance structures is that individual resonance structures do not exist. We draw them that way because they help us understand chemistry and how molecules behave. But in reality, the only thing that exists is a composite resonance structure that represents the distribution of the pi electron density around the molecule. So that would be this. So the reality of the fact is that there is partial pi electron density distributed all along that portion of the molecule. And that's what truly exists in nature. And there's a lot of ways that we can prove this, from molecular shape to just electron distribution, a lot of different things. But this is absolutely true, that it is not the case that these electrons are flipping back and forth really fast between the two oxygen atoms. In fact, the reality is this composite structure that bears an overall delocalized negative charge. So, taking a look at the nitrate ion, just as above, we can push these pi electrons to form a pi bond here. As long as we push the pi bond up to this other oxygen atom, that would give us this structure. And then likewise, the double bond can also exist on that connecting to that third oxygen. So, just as above, these are three equivalent resonance structures. But once again, it is important to understand that none of these discrete resonance structures exist. It is actually only this composite resonance structure that shows delocalized pi electron density distributed about all of the portions of the molecule that have the delocalized electron density. In this case, the whole thing. So we have a overall formal negative charge that is delocalized about the whole molecule. Now, in the prior examples, we were looking at resonance structures that were precisely equally contributing. But there could be other examples in which we have valid resonance structures that are not equally contributing. So let's take a look at why that might be. So for here, let's see that we have a formal positive charge on this carbon. Now, these pi electrons are delocalizable, so we could lose this bond to oxygen and neutralize that carbon, right? If this pi bond moves down here, oxygen will lose an electron, carbon will gain an electron, therefore carbon will neutralize, but now oxygen will have a formal positive charge. Now, this is a case where we have the formal charge on two different kinds of atoms, depending on which resonance structure we're looking at. Now, because this is a positive charge, the atom of the two that is more electropositive will have an easier time accommodating that formal positive charge. So we know about electronegativity, and we know that oxygen, because of its position in the periodic table, is more electronegative than carbon. Therefore, carbon is more electropositive. Because carbon is more electropositive, it can better accommodate the positive charge, and therefore, this resonance structure is more strongly contributing. So they are both valid resonance structures. However, the composite resonance structure would show a skewing of the partial pi electron density closer to the carbon atom, or actually, in this case, more towards the oxygen, because the carbon can better accommodate the positive charge. Now let's look at precisely the opposite scenario. Over here we have a formal negative charge on that carbon. So this is an enolate anion that we will see quite a bit later. And we can see that that can go ahead and form a carbon-carbon double bond, kicking this pi bond up onto that oxygen atom, giving the other resonance structure with the oxyanion. Now this is precisely the opposite case. We have two resonance structures, each with a formal negative charge, but they are on two different kinds of atoms. So here, because it's a formal negative charge, it's the more electronegative atom that is going to be able to accommodate the negative charge best. In this case, it's the oxygen. So this is the more strongly contributing resonance structure. This is still a valid resonance structure, but the distribution of the electron density on the composite resonance structure is going to more closely resemble this resonance structure. And then lastly, if we look at an example like this, where let's say this pi bond goes and leaves that nitrogen and just plops a negative charge right there on that carbon, this is a valid resonance structure. However, resonance structures with all neutral atoms are necessarily more contributing than other valid resonance structures that have formal positive or negative charges. So that's why this is going to be a much more strongly contributing resonance structure overall. And lastly, any resonance structure must be a valid Lewis dot structure. So we can't have a resonance structure where carbon has five bonds or some other thing that violates the rules of Lewis dot structures. So hopefully this clarifies a little bit about resonance and how to draw proper resonance structures. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. And as always, feel free to email me with questions, professordaveexplains@gmail.com.